Yeah, we've gone again. The most beautiful things. Absolutely made up with that. Nothing focuses a mind like a deadline, and whether that's at work or at school, paying your credit card bill, buying a rod license, or your latest speeding fine back to the police, there are some dates that none of us can afford to miss. For me, the end of the season is always very important, and I've come out today with a month left of the season to see if I can get a cheeky back-end barbel. Behind me, the mighty River Trent, and arguably the finest barbel river in the country at the moment. Now, today it's running cold and clear, so tactics, we've got to keep the bait down, so it's a simple block ender, putting a bit of hemp through with casters and maggots on the hook. Hardware-wise, I'm fishing with a rod that I thought would never see the light of day. Britain's sexiest match brand have gone a little bit green and introduced a range of specimen rods. So this is the rod that I thought I'd never see. Guru's first step into the specialist market. Today I'm fishing with the 1.75 pound N-gauge specimen jewel, and it's called jewel because it comes with two tops. That's a sort of an old school Avon top, as well as a carrier top, taking two quiver tips that are graded to suit the rods. And they come, this is the heaviest one, the 1.75. You also get a 1.5 pound test curve and a 1.25. There's also a fourth rod in the range that Matt Godfrey calls Big Bertha, which I find quite amusing, which is a 2.25 pound barbel rod. There is no quiver tip section with that rod. It's just a straight through specialist rod. So, is this the moment when I'm going to get my cheeky back end barbel? I've had a storming great big bite. I've had a bit of trouble with a bait runner, which I don't normally use a bait runner, and I've probably had it set a little bit loose and then struggled to get anything back on the fish, which has gone absolutely ripping off downstream. So it's quite a good moment. So it's actually the first fish that I've hooked on these rods. So this is my first look at them as well. What I can tell you is that looking at that, it's definitely a through action rod, which is really nice to play a fish with. But it's not particularly soppy or soft through action, which sort of gives it a little bit of casting beef when you need it. But there is a little bit of power through the middle. Now I know the rod, because I talked to Guru about the construction of these rods. It's made with two types of carbon, two different types of cloth, and that does give you a rod that has a little bit more progressive action than through. And my word, anybody ever said barbel don't fight when the water's cold, should be standing in my shoes at the moment. So yeah, so there's a heavier grade of, you know, a stiffer type of carbon used on the butt section than there is the top section. I've chosen to use a quiver tip today because obviously I'm not fishing with a particularly heavy feeder, just a 2 ounce one, and I have got quite a small hook on, so I'm sort of trying to make things as balanced as I can make them. But as with barbel, in most cases, the quiver tip isn't, you know, there's no doubt when you get a bite, it's not really going to, it's not all about the quiver tip. But I have to say, that is quite a nice action for a specialist rod, because it can be very, very through. So you can see just in that middle area where the push-in joint is, where it joins the top section, that can be very soft through there, because sometimes manufacturers will make it a little bit, you know, they'll overcompensate for that bit, and they become a little bit too soft. But I have to say, that's quite impressive. Matt Godfrey had said to me about getting Big Bertha out, you'd probably need it, Mark, but I can see why. Goodness me. They don't half hang on. We're winning a bit of line back. I'm never going to be able to bully this fish much. I don't think it's, I'm hoping it's not too snaggy out there, but I'm going to take it very steady because I haven't got a very heavy hook length on. Like I say, I'm fishing with a 16, which isn't a particularly large hook, but and it's certainly not a very heavy line. So I was beginning to wonder if I was going to catch one. Because of the last couple of days have sort of made me think, yeah, I've got to get, I want to really get to the river and catch a barbel, you know. So I've got my river fix, even if I don't manage to get back out before the season comes to an end. The thing with barbel is that they run off, you know, so you've got to get them back. So, yeah, so it's a bit like, they're like the naughty kid in the playground fish for me. You know, they rip off, you know, they nick the ball, off they run. And then it's a slog to get them back. But once you get them back, the fun really starts because they bore really hard. I'm just moving down to a little lower bit because the fish is coming close. They really bore. So once you get them off the bottom and moving, they bore down to get back to the bottom. I mean, and that's when you do need a bit of softness under your rod tip, because if you lock up on them, they're so powerful. When they do that, they try and get back to the bottom, it can be really difficult. It certainly tests your tackle, and that's when you know the quality of your rod. But so far, and this rod's under a lot of strain, it hasn't twisted. And I've mentioned it quite a few times when tackle testing, I like the rise to be completely inside the arc. If the blank starts to twist, then you know, it shows it's not maybe been put together properly, and that's not a bad fish at all. So I think we can net him. First one of the day. Oh, we like that. Gotcha. My back end barbel. And I have to say, having endured the hot weather this summer, which is really difficult, that may be the best barbel I've had this year. So it just goes to show that it's worth making the effort before the deadline hits. What a workout for the new N-gauge rods. Not that expensive. I think they're coming in at about £119, but I was very, very impressed with the little bit of extra power that was there. Casting wise, you never need to cast rods that particularly far, so not a problem, but hugely impressed on a reasonably light line and small hook to have landed that. And certainly, you know, loads of fun to play a fish on. There's lots of feeling through the rod, and I'm absolutely made up with that. Before we so rudely interrupted, I was going to have a chat to you about how this rod is put together and what its fixtures and fittings are. I'll just chuck it out and see, and it's gone virtually immediately. So whilst I'm playing this one, I'll talk a little bit about what this rod's got going for it. I mean, we've talked a little bit and you can see the action. I mean, yeah, quite impressive action. We've got a four cork handle, which is quite nice and sort of in keeping with a specialist or specimen rod. There's a casting grip down here, so it's quite comfortable to cast with, although I think, you know, with this type of rod, it'd be really good for sort of summer tension, big bream, but it's not a rod for casting long distances. Anything on the river is absolutely fine, but I don't think it's meant for mega distances. And that's always been a bit of a strange grey area with how fishing rods are made, because your specialist rod, as in carp rods, go on test curves. But like when you get a twin top like this is a dual, you do get an Avon top. And obviously the Avon top is the one that's probably listed with its breaking strain. And interestingly, if you always wonder what lead should I use with a certain breaking strain? So the rule of thumb is you take the test curve, say 2.25 or 2.5, add, you know, probably quarter to a half an ounce to that, and that gives you its lead carrying capacity. That's not an exact science, but it's sort of pretty much rule of thumb. I mean, when you get to sort of, obviously, even if you want a specialist, or once you get to big, you know, big flooded river rods, and you're casting 6, maybe 8 ounces, that tends to fall away a little bit, because you're then looking at sort of 180 gram feeder rods, which are rated by their casting weight more than their test curve actions. But obviously, once you start and go up to sort of 100 plus grams casting weight rods, you do lose a lot of things like this play in action, which is absolutely lovely. They're fun to use. You know, you use that softness because besides the fact of your line and your hook and everything, the actual design of the rod is cushioned. So you've got there's an added bit of cushioning there. And that is, you know, one of the main things you get with this specialist type rod. And like I touched earlier, when they do that, when the barb will lunge, you know, he's trying to get back down into the bottom in the rocks, there's enough pushing in the rod, because obviously when mono's at a full length away from you, it's quite a bit of stretching it. There's much stretching it when it's that close. And then it obviously extension, it puts extra strain on your hook length and your hook. And that's when breakages occur. But with this type of rod, which is quite soft in its action, you can see it's done it again there. I mean, it's a perfect example. It can't break it. You know, if you lock the reel up, it will, but you do get that extra cushioning. And look at that. I mean, I sort of hadn't caught barbel this late in the year before, but I have to say that the condition of them in winter is absolutely incredible. Look at that. They are the most beautiful things. There we have it, barbel number two, that, you know, quickly followed on from barbel number one, although he's not quite as big. And I mean, I think, you know, if you're a keen river angler and you like, your barbel fishing, I mean, they are simply stunning creatures. Absolutely beautiful, scale perfect. And I had no idea that they look so good in the winter. So with a regained composure, let's have a little look at their fixtures and fittings. And there's a couple of interesting things I think that Guru have done here. Firstly, we've got a two-piece construction. So the joint's more or less in the middle. There's a nice bit of reinforcing there. Like I touched on earlier, got two types of carbon. There's a 40-ton cloth down here, which is of quite high grade, and it moves on up, and there's a 30-ton up through the rest of the rod through to the carrier sections. Fittings-wise, really high grade, AAA grade cork handle with a casting grip, EVA casting grip. We've got a nice little fixed keeper ring, and it's nicely out the way. It's nicely underneath the rod, which proves it's been put together by anglers, because if you put them on the side, they stick in your finger. Guides, anti-frap sea guides with a sort of a ceramic lining. Now, anti-frap guides, you know, are very modern, and the idea that they're slightly forward facing is because that helps with line travel, so you don't get any sort of frap ups, or, you know, you shouldn't snag up whilst you're casting. Now, what I'm quite interested with this rod is that because of the type of rod, the fact that, you know, you could be on the Trent, there's a lot of rocks, and, you know, the rods may get thrown around, they've got double guides, but they haven't just got them on the butt sections, nor as can happen. They've got the double guides all the way through, and that for me shows that Guru have thought long and hard about these rods. And for a match brand, because let's face it, they haven't really brought out a bad rod as a match brand, this is the first step into this market, nicely thought out. But when you look at some of the anglers they've got, including Macy, who is, you know, gone from being a national treasure as a decathlete to being, you know, he's got a fair track record now with big fish, especially barbel. So I think he's had a long, hard look and had an involvement with the lads with this rod. So moving on up to the tip, every rod, so you've got sort of three rods, the 125, the 150 and the 175 test curve models come with graded tips. You know, they're a little bit matchy with the orange end, which is a little clue that maybe Guru don't know it all, because I would have done them white, because barbel and specimen rods tend to be white, but I'm just being picky now. But even they have quite big guides on them, so should you want to use for some reason a shock leader, or you're on thicker lines or even braids, and these are braid friendly guides, you won't be having any problems at all with the fixtures and fittings of these rods. Bit of a bittersweet moment this, because as I put these rods away, that is the end of my river season. However, they won't be sitting in the corner of the shed gathering dust, because I think that they will make ideal still water rods, both for float work with a really light one, and also sort of light feeder work for tench and bream. And then come the start of the season, I may well have a go with a big berth, and hopefully we'll get to film it. But as far as the river season goes, that's it. And thank you very much, Guru. Really enjoyed your new Engage rods.